as these technologies are coming online at various points in time, what are these gaps in the community or cattle as well? So one of the gaps I kind of noticed is that we actually don't have a big data approach to any physical analysis of the genotypes. And I mean, that's exactly where we started with genetic selection, right? And there's still some of the most heritable traits we have. Pretty much exclusively dairy and beef alike. You just have somebody go out and store them. So that's, when you work with a human, you're rather limited in terms of scale, how much time can they spend on a cow, that's how many traits you can pull off. exact meter sheet, each image you get the number that tells you how much of that color is there, and then you basically mix it like a color palette. It's pretty common to go ahead and do the easiest impression, is just take a grayscale where each of those pixels has like a intensity value. So some of the vision analysis stuff that's already out there is made to work with this pixel level information, right? So the oldest and kind of the go-to is called eigenbase algorithms, which is really just a very complicated way of saying principal component analysis on an image. If you've never heard much of principal component, basically what it does is your computer goes in, it looks at all these pictures, and it says, okay, this one feature, maybe it's the eyebrow, maybe it's the nose, this is the most interesting out of the set, pulls it onto the basis image. Then it goes back after it's counted that and said, okay, this is the most dominant feature, picks it out, does that. And they'll basically just have a handful of basic things that describe your data set and question marks. So that has kind of two problems with it. The first way is it's kind of hard to interpret what those things mean. It's not very intuitive, which I don't really like about it. The other problem is it's not supervised, which means that you can't tell the computer that you want to do face shape. So that means that if you have variable background things, it's likely to be like, oh, it's very important that you have a red brow and pull that off when you really don't care. So I don't think this is ever really going to be very feasible for livestock applications. So kind of the second gen is neural networks, which is basically just a nonlinear version of principal component analysis with a fancier name. And deep learning networks have been doing some really cool stuff recently. So what they do a really good job is actually breaking these problems down point selection. Usually we get error in one direction, which is kind of nice. So I want to look at correlation between error terms. So for the eye, obviously, way more right speed. We've got a lot more biometrics for the normalized links that are concerning the correlated errors. Muzzle, same deal. Top line, they're actually about equivalent. That little blip on the G-measure biometrics on the right was actually related to how I did the length measures, which I've actually redone recently. And forehead, same deal. The normalized links are way more correlated in errors than the G-measure biometrics. So with me out on this, so basically, G-measure biometrics overall have more resistance variations in image quality, which if you ever try to control, is a good thing. It's one less thing to worry about when you're trying not to hit the face back up. Additionally, the G-measure biometrics are less correlated in errors, which causes a lot less problems for any basically any type of linear operator that we use in animal reading. And then finally, the G-measure biometrics for bony traits have a huge buffer of readability, which means that you basically deal with less noise. The one thing that I can put a number on is basically that the geometric biometrics are way easier to work with in terms of interpreting what's going on. You're describing nose shape with 100 different pairwise combinations. I'm used to working with large data sets, but I have no idea what's going on. Whereas the geometric biometrics, because it's a very targeted thing, it's a lot easier to do diagnostics, which is a statistician I like. All right, so that's all the really boring measurement validation stuff. So you're probably wondering, why is this kid talking about faces or cows? So all of the stuff that I've mentioned, this actual algorithm work, it should apply to anything that you want to work with in terms of if you want to do leg traits or, fat traits or fat positioning, that type of stuff. The algorithmic solutions hold. So the reason I mentioned faces, though, so I grew up in a horse world, specifically the Arab world. So we have all these old adages about, this nose is really friendly and its eyes are really competitive and, all this really kind of crazy stuff. There's actually a wee bit of literature out there that supports that idea, the main one being the Foxworm experiment, which is, a big one for behavioral genetics. So basically, they took these wild foxes for about 50 years, they bred them exclusively to be tame. By the end of it, they got foxes that acted like dogs, also looked like dogs. Particularly, they got a lot of changes in face shape that looked pretty similar to the same type of changes you see for domesticated animals. And I'm not a functional genomics person at all, but basically what they proposed was they saw massive changes in hormone profiles during development, and they made some hypotheses of, it was the hormone development that was changing behavior, and you just have this kind of size stuff happening on the face. So it's kind of cool that you can change the or select the behavior, get all these physical things. It would actually kind of be a lot more convenient to pick the physical things in the opposite direction. So that's what I've been playing around with for the past few years. So on the application side, I've still mostly preliminary phases. One thing I did was speak on the accelerated genetics website, picked out about 60 out of samples to pull off all their shown EBDs and health rates, and basically correlated them to 16 of my biometrics out of the 160. So basically what I found just doing some basic linear stuff was that after you accounted for the confirmation, you could actually account for another 20 to 40% of the variability in health rates just using traits continue to correlate well with self traits. Also, we're going to look at some order data from a random farm we're working with. So we're also going to start to explore all these self traits that significantly correlate, or all these biometrics that significantly correlate to health. Do they in turn correlate to any interesting herd dynamic traits? All right, so that's about all I got. So obviously, thanks to my lab. They've been really good helping with all of those. Also, Aurora again, some of the local students who are living here on the farm and basically paparazzi in their house and directly off the air.
So all the work so far you've done with facial biometrics?